Okay. Hello, everyone. My name is Hadzakis Dimitris, and I will present to you our review with the name of Deep Learning Methods for Tumor Segmentation and Detection in X-ray Breast Imaging. Let's start with why did we tackle the problem of cancer? Well, it has a psychological impact concerning all the patient's stress and anxiety it creates. It has a humanitarian aspect regarding the loss of life, and high economic importance because each patient has to undergo a lot of procedures, surgeries, chemotherapies, radiations, and other diagnostic examinations. And lastly, in some cases, such as our case, we have large data sets depending on the type of the cancer. And we chose deep learning because it's the best known technique for image detection and classification, and it's also constantly improving. Breast cancer is the most common form of cancer found in women, and mammography is considered the best method to diagnose it early and thus mitigate survival rates. It has found it reduces mortality around 35% in women aged 50 to 69 years of age, and it occurs in the ducts and lobules of the breast as shown in the picture. Mammograms are as depicted below, and this shows pictures of breasts with increasing density. It's noteworthy that extreme dense breasts, and the denser the breast is, it's usually more difficult to diagnose a tumor. The lesions that occur are masses, tumors actually, yeah. They can be circumscribed, well-defined, or indistinct, which are ill-defined, or speculated, as can be seen here. Then there's calcifications. We can be benign, usually happening occurring in the skin, suspicious, either amorphous or they're very heterogeneous, and they indicate a high probability of malignance. Here are some cases. CAD now, computer as aided diagnosis, is something that is employed nowadays a lot due to its main advantages of its automation of the diagnostic process, of making hopefully less mistakes than humans nowadays in some aspect, in certain areas in the future, hopefully more.
CAD, yeah.
So CAD, the advantages of CAD is, as I said, the automation of the diagnostic process, the fact that it can make less mistakes in certain cases and hopefully even less in the future. It processes fast large amounts of data and complex data. And the main aim of the project is to create earlier detection and thus better prognosis. Areas of application include diabetic retinopathy, breast cancer, non-polypoid lesions in CT colonography, and brain fMRI for psychiatric disease classification. Major hurdles include the lack of high quality curated datasets and subpar performance of some of the existing algorithms. Now, in this review, what we did was search through the archive database of papers with the keywords deep learning and neural networks, along with the keywords mammogram and breast. And this resulted in more than 350 papers. Of these papers, due to some accuracy filter, which was accuracy below 8% and the area under care below 85%, all those papers were dropped. Also, relevance was an issue because a lot of these papers didn't contain exactly neural networks, so we dropped those as well. And lastly, we had several papers whose architecture was very similar, and this way we kept only the ones that had the best results. Of those seven, in order to accommodate the time frame and the length of the project, we arrived on the four most important ones due to their high accuracy or certain types of innovation. The first example has included in the extreme learning machine. How it starts is that you have a mammogram, you extract a region of interest, and you parse it through a dual tree complex wavelet transformation, which is basically a transformation of like a Fourier transform, but instead of cosines and sines, it's a more complex mathematical feature. Then it's parsed through a hidden Markov tree, which basically penalizes all coefficients that are not sequentially the same. Like if the coefficient is large, the triplet of coefficients around it must be also large to be augmented. And if they're not, it's the triplet is penalized. Then it's passed to a genetic algorithm, which is a sequential sequence of data, and a crossover point is selected on the data on that data, and then these two pairs of data are mixed and matched like chromosomes, and we create two offsprings which are different. These two offsprings also have a chance to have random mutations in order to create some randomness and imitate the evolutionary process. And this whole result is passed through an extreme learning machine, which is basically a neural network with a hidden node whose weights are fixed, are frozen. So this way it's trained faster and is more efficient. This was done on three different datasets, on the Mayas, which had 26 rows extracted from it, on the Nijmegen, which had 103 rows extracted from it, and on the DDSM, which had 150 rows extracted from him from it. And these are the results you see of area under curve. In the next example we studied, it's the ResNet 34 architecture, which was not that innovative per se, because it's relatively old and it's mainly a convolution layers with a residual connection every third one. But what was really innovative about it and amazed us was the fact that it pitted human against machine and let the machine and the human compete for classification. So in the first regime, they had humans do the classification and they had an AUC of 0.81. Then a hybrid regime where the machine created a classification, but the human, after this suggestion, decided ultimately, and we had an AUC of 0.881. And lastly, when just the machine classified, we had an AUC of 0.959. Then we go on to our third example, which is an ensemble of cascades. And what happens here is that we have a mammogram. This mammogram is passed through a DBLIF network. The DBLIF network is your run-of-the-mill neural network, only that it's not trained through a forward and a backward pass. It's trained in two layers at once, an input layer and a hidden layer. And then the hidden layer becomes the input layer, and the second hidden layer becomes the hidden layer. And this back and forth goes on in pairs until the whole network is trained. And then this whole data was passed through a Gaussian mixture model, where the data is assumed to be simulated by a finite amount of Gaussians with unknown parameters, and the parameters are fitted. After this, it was parsed through a cascade of two region CNNs or RCNNs, which are basic convolutional networks, which have two types of outputs. They output a box, and through that box, a regressor, which this regressor refines that box in order to better fit the objects inside of it, and an SVM or a support vector machine, which is a classification. The SVM works by taking an n-dimensional type of data, which, as you can see here, for example, is two-dimensional, orange and blue dots. And in order to classify and separate them, it creates an extra dimension, or more if necessary, here a third one, in order to be able for the machine to better classify them and separate them. Then it's passed through a cascade of two random forests, which is basically an ensemble of decision trees, each one outputting a class. There's majority voting, who decides on which class is picked. And then the rows are extracted. These bounding boxes on the rows need to be refined. And this is why Bayesian optimization is decided, where you have some data on the boxes. And then we see the major parts of uncertainty about it. And we find the maximum of that uncertainty. And then we take a new data acquisition on that point of uncertainty. That's reducing it. And then we go do that iteratively a lot of times to arrive on the final bounding box. Here, this study was done on the IMPRES dataset of 410 mammograms with a sensitivity of 0.96 and a specificity of 0.7. And here we have at last the faster RCNN, a type of region convolutional network again. Here we have a convolution with convolutional network, which is a backbone. Here is the inception version 2, and which is parsed through afterwards to the region proposal network. The region proposal network is what it actually does is takes the image and creates anchors in certain pixels. And on each of these anchors, it applies, as you can see, boxes, bounding boxes of three different shapes, orthogonals and squares, and of three different sizes. And through training, the sizes which have intersection over union of 0.7 or more are considered positive, less than 0.3 negative, while the in-between is neglected. This training occurs, and after that, the bounding boxes go again, like every CNN, RCNN, to a regressor to be refined and to a classifier to decide if the bounding box inside has a tumor or not. The backbone here is the, as I aforementioned, the inception version 2 network. It, in this case, let's say you have these pictures of animals and of dogs. Each dog has a different aspect of his presence, his figure presented to us, and different percentage, and he has different stance. Also taking up different space of the picture. In order for a network to decide all this and to find it out, it needs different kernels, different types of convolutions. So what the inception network does, because it's very difficult to do it in a deep manner, it goes wide. So in its layer, it tries to do that all at the same time. Like in the picture I put in below. However, the version 2 network splits every 5-to-5 convolution network to 2 3-by-3 convolutions, and it's 3-by-3 to a 3-by-1 and then 1-by-3. Here we have two datasets, the OMIDB and the INBREST, while where the OMIDB is split into OMIH and OMIG. The OMIH part of the dataset was used in every case to first train the network, while in the cases of the OMIDB, the OMIG was used for fine-tuning, and then the INBREST was used separately for its malignant case and for its benign, again, for fine-tuning. So the results here is area under curve of 0.8587 for the OMIDB with sensitivity of 0.76 and a specificity of 0.88, while the INBREST, the benign case, has an AUC of 0.95, sensitivity of 0.95, again, a specificity of 0.7, while we have lower and worse results for the malignant case. This table surmises all the above, and thank you for your attention, and I will gladly accept any questions.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Dimitris Tsatsakis. now the question, please. I have a first question, maybe. From point of view of doctor, being a doctor and physiologist, the real result for doctors of your proposal, of your research, what is the early diagnostic or more precise diagnostic? What is the...
Well, this is kind of, in general, computer vision in medicine is kind of a shot in the dark. The aspiration is to do both.
Yeah.
It's to have better detection, better diagnostics, and also earlier diagnostics. But...
Good. Good, thank you. Thank you for. So, any question? Please, Dr. Victoria Poscurte, please.
Okay, first of all, I will introduce myself. I'm an anesthesiologist, passionate with data science, machine learning, and related fields. I'm working with some applications, and this area is one of the area of interest, and I'm a little bit familiar. I would like to thank Dimitris for your very interesting
report.
And first of all, about the multitude of techniques, including CNN, including flat multilayer perceptron, etc., genetic algorithm, etc. And one of the slides over there, probably the one before you switch to the larger version, was, as far as I can recall, about ensembles. And over there, there was such an interesting information concerning sensitivity and specificity. Sensitivity was quite high for this particular model, something around 96%, while specificity was only 70%. Yes, this one. In this case, there is a risk of false alarm. How you solve this issue in a practical environment?
Well, I'm not sure exactly, but this specific case, due to the IMPRES database, the IMPRES database is pretty small. It's 410 mammograms. Okay, so maybe this is an issue of the data set. So from an engineering wise perspective, the first thing that I would do, because I have like, how do you say it? Anyway, the first thing that I would do was create, use more data sets, more data. And then if that doesn't work, I would see if something else is the problem, maybe an architectural issue with the network or, yeah. But mainly the first thing that I would do is use more data,
find more data. I got, and I absolutely agree with you, but I'm asking now as a doctor, as a physician, how would you recommend the physician in case you provide him or her with such a system with this type of metrics, performance metrics? How the doctor should approach such a system?
Yeah, I'm not a doctor, so I don't know exactly how you should approach it. I mean, it's something that is relatively now developing. It's not, it is state of the art, but that doesn't mean that it's deployable or for use in clean kind of environments yet, especially this one.
Sure.
Yeah.
Thank you.